Good morning to all. This is Dr. Prashant Mandre from Dharwad. Today, I am going to discuss about the literary movements. Literary movements are the very important part in a certain net examinations. Literary movements are a way to divide literature into categories for similar philosophical topical and aesthetic features as opposed to a division by genres or period. We already heard so many names called Bloomsbury Group, Imagism, Stream of Consciousness, Absurd Theater, Kitchen Sink. You know, these type of literary movements comes under a literature, and in a certain net examination, they are asking who is not belongs to this group, or who is belongs to a Bloomsbury group or Imagism, who started that, and when it has comes, who, what is the type of writing of theirs. So literary movements are like other categorization they are doing. Literary movements provide a language for comparing and discussing literary works. So let's discuss about one by one. You know, in the beginning, it started with Scottish Chaucerians. The name given to a group of 15th and 16th century Scottish poets who wrote under the influence of Geoffrey Chaucer or his follower John Lydiate often used the seven line rhyme royal stanza. They are following a rhyme royal stanza. The most important poet of this group is Robert Henderson, whose Pentament of Cressida continues to reinterpret the story of Chaucer's Troilus and Cressidas. The William Dunbar, whose Lament on the Machaerus briefly pays tribute to the Chaucer. Other figures of the Scottish Chaucerians: Gavin Duggles, Sir David Lindsay, and King James I of Scotland. They are the practitioner of these Scottish Chaucerians. First is Robert Henderson, William Dunbar, Gavin Duggles, Sir David Lindsay, and King James I. The term unfortunately divert attention from the geniusly original character of these poets, and thus does not match favored in a Scottish. They have created the Aureate Diction, a highly ornate poetic diction favored by the Scottish Chaucerian and some of the English poets in the 15th century, notably John Lydiate. The Aureate style, perfected by William Dunbar, is notable for its frequent use of internal rhymes and coinage adopted for Latin. So Aureate Diction, what is Aureate Diction? In one of our set examination, it has been asked. Just, it is developed by John William Dunbar, and it is about rhymes, internal rhyme in the poetry. And the next group is University Wits. You all know that who are the University Wits in a Elizabethan period. The name is given some important literary historians to a group of English poets and playwrights who established themselves in London in the 1580s and 1590s after the attending university at either Oxford or Cambridge. The most important member of this group was Christopher Marlowe. Christopher Marlowe, you all know that, who has written a wonderful tragedies, who influenced Shakespeare to write many works, and he is Dr. Faustus, Thumbeline, Edward II, Jew of Malta. You know, he has written a very wonderful dramas in a literature, whose powerful blank verse plays prepared the way of Shakespeare. Other included George Peele, Robert Greene, Thomas Nash, John Lilly, and Thomas Lodge. Thomas Kidd is also sometime included in the group, though he is not believed to have studied at university. And you should remember that here, all the dramatists of University Wits who studied in Oxford or Cambridge universities. The term university word was used in their lifetime, but it was coined by George Saintsbury in 19th century. He is a journalist and author. The flair of the university, which had several features in his common, especially their heroic themes and their heroic treatment, the great fullness of varieties, splendid descriptions, long swelling speeches, and handling of violent incident and emotions. The style was also heroic. You know, they are using the heroic things. The theme were usually tragic in nature for the dramatist, where has a role too much and earnest to give heed to what was considered to be the lower species of comedies. And the next group is comedy of humor. Now, English literature, actually, there are comedy of humor, comedy of manner, and in a restoration period, it's a comedy of sentiment that has came. And after that, in a 20th century, Harold Pinter has started the comedy of menace. You know, there are four things comes in that. Comedy of humors is very important. The most, the comedy of humors is introduced by the playwright Ben Jonson in the late 16th century. The term derived from the Latin humor, more properly humor, meaning liquid, and it is used in medieval and Renaissance medical theory that the human body held a balance of four liquid humors: blood, phlegm, yellow boil, and black boil. You know, you should remember that here they are discussing about four liquids of human bodies: blood, phlegm, yellow boil, and black boil. In one of our question paper, it has been asked that it is not belongs to in comedy of humors. The answer was other thing was there, the cholera they have mentioned. So when properly balanced, these humors were thought to have the individual a healthy mind in a healthy body. It is very important. An individual, a healthy mind in a healthy body. They are writing about these things. The comedy of humor, best exemplified by Ben Jonson play Every Man in His Humor. You know, he has written Every Man in His Humor, Every Man in Out of His Humor, and Wolfano and Euponius. They are the very important works of Ben Jonson. You should read about him. And in the next group, the next movement is Son of Ben's. After so many writers of Carolian age, they have followed Ben Jonson's style. Here, the follower of Ben Jonson in English poetry, the drama, the first half of the 17th century, the main followed by Ben Jonson philosophy and his or poetry. These men, unlike Jonson, were loyal to the king. They are very loyal to the king for Charles I. Sons of Ben were the dramatists who were overtly and admittedly influenced by Jonson's drama, his most distinctive artistic achievement. Where Jonson, you know, one of a great writer who has followed all the three unities in his drama. That's why Dryden is telling that I like Ben Jonson in a dramatic poesy. Dryden has favor with Ben Jonson. John Lee Davies, you know, he listed 11 playwrights in this group: Richard Brome, Thomas Nades, Henry Gapthrones, Thomas Killigrew, Sir William Davenant, William Cartwright, Sacrerly Marilyn, Joseph Mann, Peter Housted, Thomas Randolph, and William Cavendish. You know, William Davenant is one of an important writer who has started heroic couplet in English literature. The term, the Ben, Son of Ben's, also alternatively called as Tribe of Ben, was self-description by some of the Cavalier poets who admired were influenced by Jonson poetry, including Robert Herrick, Richard Lovelace, Sir John Suckling, and Thomas Carew. You know, one of our writer of Cavalier writer who got suicide when Charles won his thrown away from the country. Johnson and his followers congregated at London taverns, especially the Apollo Room in the Devil Tavern near Temple Bar. So another very important movement is metaphysical poets. Metaphysical poet is one of the greatest movement comes in English literature, especially in the 16th and 17th century literature, where John Donne, one of the great poet who has followed the metaphysical things, who has used extended metaphors, conceits he has used in his poems, his comparison is unbelievable. The name is given to a diverse group of 17th century English poets whose work is notable for its ingenious use of intellectual theological concepts and surprising concepts, strange paradox, and far-fetched imaginary things they have mentioned. The leading metaphysical poet was John Donne, whose colloquial, argumentative abruptness of rhythm and tone distinguishes his style from the conviction of Elizabethan love lyric. Other poets to whom the label is applied is Andrew Marvell, Abraham Cowley, John Cleveland, and religious poets George Herbert, Henry Wagon, and Richard Crenshaw. So John Donne has written a religious poem also and romantic poem also, where George Herbert, Henry Wagon, and Richard Crenshaw, purely they are writing about religious things. The term metaphysical poet was coined by Samuel Johnson in the chapter of, while he is writing the leaves of the most eminent English poets, while he is discussing about Abraham Cowley, he has coined this metaphysical poets. In the 20th century, writer, one of a great modern critic, T.S. Eliot and other revived their reputation, stressing their quality of wit in the sense of intellectual strengthness and flexibility rather than the smart humor. T.S. Eliot told that that John Donne is one of a very great writer of English literature. Cavalier writer, you know, after that, though they are cavalier writers are following Ben Jonson's style, but they have a writing about some parliament, the supporters of parliaments. They are called as cavalier. Cavalier means nothing but it's Charles I's followers. Charles I's follower is called as cavalier poets. Any of the group of English gentlemen poets called cavalier because of their loyalty to a Charles I during the English Civil War, as opposed to a roundheads who supported parliaments. They were also cavalier in their style of life and counted the writing of polished and elegant lyric as only one of their many accomplishments as soldier, courtiers, gallants, and wits. The term embraced Richard Lovelace, Thomas Carew, John Suckling, and Edmund Valier, and Robert Herrick. They are the cavalier poets. You should remember these writers and their works. Scribblers' Club, it's also a very important group in 18th century British literature, some whose founding members of brilliant Tory wits, Alexander Pope, John Nathan Swift, John Gay, Thomas Parnell, and John Arbuthnot. Its purpose was to be ridiculous, presumptuous, erudition, and scholarly jargon through the person of a fictitious literary hack, Martinus Scribblers. The name Martin was taken from the John Dryden's comic character, Mr. Martin Marr, all whose name had become a synonym with the absurd error. Scribblers was a reference to a scribbler, the contemporary term, the contempt for a talentless writer. Graveyard poetry, you know, after the development of English literature, till that we are only reading about the religious and some societal things. After that, when the Restoration period introduced, the writing skill have changed. You know, Greenland poets is they are focusing on the emotions of a man. The term applied to a minor but influence of 18th century tradition of mediate poem of morality and immorality, often set in graveyard. Graveyard, you all know that. Oh, they are writing about grave things and all. The so-called graveyard school of poetry in England and Scotland was not in fact an organized group. The best known example of this melancholic kind of a verse as a night piece on death by the Irish poet Thomas Parnell, Edward Young's Night Thought, and the Scottish clergyman Robert Blair's The Grave, and the culmination of the tradition in English, Thomas Gray's Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard. You know, Thomas Parnell, Edward Young, Robert Blair, and Thomas Gray are a prominent writer of graveyard poetry, especially Thomas Gray's Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard, who is written about one of a friend had died, and he is writing about this poem. This work had many imitators in Europe and constitute a significant current of a free romantics. After the transitional period, when the romanticism has started, the romanticism has one of a very important period in English literature, where the lake poets especially came, a group of English poets who all lived in a lake district of England, United Kingdom, the first half of the 19th century. As a group, they followed no single school of thought or literary practice then. They were named only to be uniformly disparaged by the Edinburgh Review. They are considered the part of romantic movements. They have born in a lake district, that's why they have called as a lake poets. The three main figure, what has been become known as the lake poets, were William Wordsworth, Samuel Tyler Coleridge, and Robert Southey. These three called as a lake poets. Some other poets is also there, but these are very important figures of lake poets. You know, they were associated with the several other poets also comes in lake poets, especially Dorothy Wordsworth, the sister of Wordsworth, Charles Lamb, one of a great essayist of 19th century, Mary Lamb, sister of Charles Lamb, Charles Lyot, Hartley Coleridge, John Wilson, and Thomas D. Quincey, who has written The Opium Eater. Opium Eater is one of our great work. So Thomas D. Quincey also belongs to a lake poet, but majorly you should remember that Wordsworth, H.T. Coleridge, and Robert Southey belongs to a lake poets. They were first described decoratively as the lake school by Francis Jeffrey in the Edinburgh Review. Okay, Francis Jeffrey first told that they are lake poets. After that, the satanic school, you know, pejorative designation used by Robert Southey, most notably in the preface of A Vision of Judgment. In A Vision of Judgment, he has told a satanic school in the reference to a certain English poets whose works has he believed to be characterized by a satanic spirit of pride and audacious impiety. Although Southey did not name any of those poets in his preface elsewhere, he identified Lord Byron as the head of the satanic school, and Byron's friend P.B. Shelley is also generally understood to have been a target of Southey's opprobrium. The term exposed Southey's disapproval of unorthodox views and lifestyles of those poets and those in the circles. Cockney school, it's also another more romantic school. A dismissive name of the London-based romantic poets such as John Keats, Leigh Hunt, and P.B. Shelley. You should remember that. Who are the satanic antandre? P.B. Shelley and Byron. Here, Cockney school means John Keats, Leigh Hunt, and P.B. Shelley. The term was first used to a scathing review of a Blackwood's magazine in October 1817, in which the anonymous reviewer mocked the poet's lack of pedigree and sophistications, its primary target was Leontes. Leontes is one of the essayist of Romantic period who has supported John Keats, P.B. Shelley, and some other Romantic poet to publish their poetry in his magazine. Only Keats was properly be regarded as a Cockney. Hazlitt was not even born in London. John Scott died after a duel over the controversy. The term and the campaign against the Hunt and the others was not a question of aesthetic. It was instead an attack on the class background of the authors and their aspiration to the highest level of the literary. And it was additionally a reaction to the Cockney politics of others. Transcendentalism, you know, till that we have discussed about the British literature, and in that there are so many groups out there in upcoming also they are coming. But transcendentalism is one of American theological and philosophical group, which is started by Ralph Waldo Emerson. In 19th century school of American theological and philosophical thought that combined respect of the nature and self-sufficiently with the element of Unitarianism and German Romanticism. In German also, the Romanticism has started, especially in the meantime, especially in the 19th century, when Romanticism started in British literature. In a German literature, the slanged drum, it has started by Goethe and Friedrich. And also in America, the Ralph Waldo Emerson has started this transcendentalism. And he was the primary practitioner of the movement, and he exiled loosely in the Massachusetts in the early 1800 before becoming organized group in 1830. Thinkers in a movement embrace ideas brought forth by philosopher Immanuel Kant and Hegel, whose Samuel Coleridge, ancient Indian scripture, the Vedas, and religious founder Immanuel Swedenborg. Transcendentalist advocates the idea of a personal knowledge of a God, believing that no intermediary was needed for spiritual insight. They embrace idealism, focusing on nature and opposing the materialism. You know, transcendentalism, they are opposing the materialism things. Emerson essay Nature, published in 1836, present and transcendentalist philosophy. The nature essay is very important in transcendentalism. In that essay, he has presented the ideas of transcendental ideas. The Transcendentalism Club on September 12, 1836, four Harvard University alumni have taken up part. Writer and bankers, many minister Frederick Henry Hodge, Ralph Waldo Emerson, and George Ripley and George Putnam is the practitioner of this transcendentalism. I left a celebration at Harvard to meet a Vidar Hotel in Cambridge. Transcendental Club were interested in forming a community to put their ideas to a test. In 1841, a small group of them, including author Nathaniel Hawthorne, moved to a property named Brook Farm in the West Roxbury, Massachusetts. So where Hawthorne is also took a part in transcendentalism. The Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, again you come to a British literature, where Pre-Raphaelite, it's an artistic movement started in the 19th century, where a group of English painters, poets, and artists found in September 1848 by William Holman Hunt, John Millies, and Dante Gabriel Rossetti have started, Dizzy Rossetti started this Pre-Raphaelite movement. The three founders were joined by William Michael Rossetti, James Collinson, Frederick George Stephen, and Thomas Fulner, two for the seven members of Brotherhood. The Pre-Raphaelites opposed the dominance of the British Royal Academy, which campaigned a narrow range of idealized or moral subject and conventional definition of a beauty drawn from the early Italian Renaissance and classical art. In contrast, the Pre-Raphaelites look inspiration from an earlier period, that is a century preceding and high Renaissance. They believed painters before the Renaissance provide a model of depicting nature and the human body realistically rather than the idealistically, and that is collective guide and medieval craft people offered an alternative vision of artistic community to mid 19th century academic approaches. Aestheticism, you know, it's also one of an important group in 19th century, which is started by two important writers of British literature, Walter Pater and Oscar Wilde. Late 19th century European arts movement, which centered on the doctrine that art exists for the sake of its beauty alone, that is, needs serve no political deducting or other purpose of the attention. This is called as art for art's sake. The movement began in the reaction to prevailing utilitarian social philosophies and to what he was perceived as the ugliness and philistinism of the industrial age. Its philosophical foundation were laid in the 18th century by Immanuel Kant, who postulated the autonomy of aesthetic standards, setting them apart from the consideration of morality, utility, or pleasure. The idea was employed by J.W. von Goethe, J.L. Treich, or other German, and Samuel Taylor Coleridge and Thomas Carlyle in England. It was populated in the French by Madame de Staël, Gautier, and philosopher Victor Cousin, who's coined the phrase L art power a lot, art for art's sake in 1818. In England, the artist, the next group is fireside poets, schoolroom poets, and household poets are same name, which is also an American group. Used by generated a group of five poets, especially William Cullen Byron, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, John Whitger, Oliver Wendell Holmes, and James Russell Lowell, were popular in America in latter half of the 19th century. Their poetry was read both around household fireside, often allowed by the mother or father to a gathered family, and the schoolrooms, where they have inculcated wisdom and morals and patriotic feeling in American, and especially in America when it has developing, they are focusing on patriotical feelings. And Ralph Emerson is also occasionally included in this group, as well as the name fireside poet is derived from the popularity their writing was source of entertainment for families gathered around the fire at home. The name was furtherly inspired by Longfellow, 1850, poetry collection, The Seaside and the Fireside. Lowell published in the book titled Fireside Travels in 1864, which helped solidify the title. Oxford movement, you know, when the Romanticism comes, when after the Restoration period, this aestheticism, there are nobody is talking about religious aspects, especially in Victoria and Romantic period, they have neglected these religious aspects. But these Oxford College students, the group of students who has start focusing on the religious aspects. An effort by Anglican clergymen of Oxford University between 1833 and 1845, a renew and Church of England by a revival of Catholic doctrine and practice. Again, the revival of Catholic and doctrine and practices has started. Leaders of this movement were John Henry Newman, Richard Proudley, John Cable, and Edward Pusey. The movement philosophy was known as Tractarianism. After its series of publication, the Tracts from the Time, published from 1832 to 1841. Tractarians were also disparalyzing, referred to a new minutes before 1845, and Puseyites. After two prominent Tractarians, John Henry Newman and Edward Pusey. Other well-known Tractarians include John Cable, Charles Marriott, Richard Proud, Robert Wilberforce, Isaac William, and William Palmer. But when you should remember the four five names importantly. Oxford movement mean Oxford movement leaders: Henry, John Henry Newman, Richard Hurrell Froude, John.